Dan and I, we got on a flight on the way back. This is a bit of an update on conference, but it also kind of ties in. So we got on a WestJet flight heading back from Abbotsford. And so there's Dan and I, and there's two other pastors who were flying out of Abbotsford. And we're all managed to get our seats all in a row. And so there we are in the plane. And I think, well, I'm just going to take my iPad and slip it into the seat pocket in front of me. So I slip it into the seat pocket, and then you know how it is. You're waiting for the flight to, you know, for them to do cross-check, you know, and lock the doors and give those little signals. So I reach in to grab the flight magazine. And I reach in and I pull the flight magazine out, and there's this substance on it. It is like the grossest looking substance you've ever seen. And my immediate thought is, ah, like this in my seat. I'm like, oh, gross, you know? Someone threw up in the seat pocket. And then Dan, there's a seat between us, and I think he was happy, you know? I think he's like, oh, you know? And then I'm thinking, okay, well, I'm just going to push the flight attendant button, but we haven't taken off yet. So I just kind of get up, and I take this magazine. I walk to the back, and there's two flight attendants in the back, and I show them this magazine. I'm like, this magazine's in my seat pocket. And they go, ah, gross, like this. And I said, well, here, you take it. And they're like, okay. And they kind of put it in the garbage. And then I went back and sat down on the flight. We're still waiting on something. And then I have this awful thought. You know where I'm going, right? I'm like, I just took my iPad and put it in the pukey seat pocket. So no matter what, I'm going in for the iPad. I reach my hand in and it's like, and I pull this thing out, and it is caked. Yeah. That's all I had today. Let's pray. Let's have open sharing. It's been a long week. I pull this thing out, and it's caked in, like, pukey substance. And I'm thinking, oh, this is gross. So I get out of my seat again. Meanwhile, the guy on the left from this other church is killing himself. Like all good pastor friends do. You got your iPad. You're hooped. Yeah, I know. So I go back now, and I go to the flight attendant to the back. I'm like, now my iPad has puke, right? And they're like, ah, oh, same reaction. We'll throw it out. No! Don't touch it. Give me a cloth right now. Okay. Well, the people at the front of the plane now call back. What's the holdup? And I can see them. You know, the two flight attendants at the front, they're like, and the two flight attendants at the back are like, we got some guy here, puke on his iPad, we'll tell you about it later. And the guys at the front, I come around the corner, and now the flight attendant says, wait, take this. And she gives me this big wad of cloth. So now I come around the corner, I've got my iPad and this huge wad of cloth, and the guy at the front has the same reaction, like, oh. I'm like this, and I'm signaling to him, this is why we're not leaving. Now three or four people in the back row are laughing, except me. And I'm cleaning off this stuff off my iPad, and I finally get it clean, and then I think, well, I'm going to have to use this seat pocket. So I thought, you know, good Samaritan moment. So I go back, I said, you girls want me to clean it out for you, the pocket? No. We'll do it. I said, no, just let me clean it out. It's not a big deal. I used to actually be a flight attendant. This is no big deal. And so they're kind of debating, and they're like, okay, fine. So they, but the one girl has this great idea, because this will just save me from everything. She says, here, take this rubber glove. So now the people at the back of the plane are starting to turn around. They see a guy with cloth, with an iPad, and now I'm doing this at the back of the plane. I'm just telling you what happened. I'm at the back of the plane. Just calm down, everybody. I have to, and so I get in there, and I clean this thing out. It's disgusting. I can say by the grace of God, I'm pretty sure it was carrot cake, which I'm so thankful for. Now, I don't mean throw up. I mean, it was carrot cake. I'd misread it, so that was my relief. I just want you to know that. And I don't care if you know different. Don't tell me. I want to believe it's carrot cake. Got it? I sat back in my seat, and the pastor, after he's wiping the tears away from his eyes, he leans over, he goes, send me the audio on that one when you use that illustration. Ed, thanks a lot for the support. But I thought, this fits perfect. And you're going, how? Hold on, let me work it. Here's the deal. We have this concept. in the Christian faith that says, I've got to take away my sin, or I've got to deal with my own sin in my own way. And I'll explain this in a second. Before God comes in. And that's just not true. The picture of God is the one who reaches in and deals with our sin. All we have to do is be honest that it's there. Modern religion, if you take the illustration of the seat pocket being like your heart and sin being this sick sort of pukey substance that the scripture says the heart is wicked and deceitful above all things, modern religion looks to mask over that by pretending things aren't as bad. Modern religion says, well, let's just either pretend it's not there or let's just compare ourselves with the seat pocket next because it has more gooey stuff in it. That's basically a definition of religion. It's the concept that I'm going to try to clean myself up and become better than the next person or try to just ignore it by doing good works. Neither of them take away sin. Now, last week, we talked about the guilt of sin. This week, we're going to talk about God's plan of reaching in and actually getting rid of it. And this is so reverse of what religion tells you. It will astound you. One speaker at the conference said this. I thought it was great. He says, oftentimes, Christianity is wrongly viewed by what we don't do. Think about that. Maybe you've thought this yourself. I know I have before I was a Christian. You know, Christians, they're the ones that don't drink or they don't do certain things or watch certain things. They don't go certain places. They don't associate with certain kinds of people. And that's often portrayed what Christianity is, sort of this set of do's and don'ts. He goes on to say, unfortunately, many so-called Christians operate under what's been called, and if you take notes, you want to write this down. It's brilliant, I think. Moralistic therapeutic deism, huh? Let me say it again. Moralistic therapeutic deism. Moralistic is basically that God blesses and takes those to heaven who try to live good and decent lives. So the idea being your heart has all this grossness in it, but if you just do your best to look good and hide it from people, that's moralism. Do your best. Therapeutic is the central goal of life is not to sacrifice or deny oneself, but to be happy and feel good about oneself. And then deism is though God created us, created the world, he does not need to be particularly involved in our lives except when there is a problem. That is a prevalent concept of what the Christian faith is all about today. It's like they're the ones that hide their sin better, or they're the ones that think they're just slightly better, and it's because of the things they do and don't do that elevate themselves. That is not it. Can I just say this? This is what the modern church is producing, sadly, today. There was a survey done with two conservative Protestant youths. They were interviewed and asked what their Christian faith meant. The first reply, well, if you just do the right thing and don't do anything bad, I mean, nothing really bad, well, you go to heaven, but if you don't, you're hooped. The second said, well, don't do any sins, read the Bible, go to church, living godly, that's about it. It's basically about not committing sin. Is that what Christianity is all about? Not messing up, just doing deeds of righteousness or good? No. In fact, keep your finger here. Turn to Galatians 2:16. It's about five blocks to the right. Galatians 2:16 says this. Now catch this, because we need to sort of nail down this concept that religion isn't doing good or not doing bad. That's not relationship, with Jesus. That's not Christianity. Knowing that a man, look what it says, verse 16 in Galatians of chapter 2. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law. Stop. There it is. The Bible says the opposite. That we are not justified because of anything we do good. Now jump down to the second part here of this. Towards the end he said that we might be justified by faith in Christ. Here it is. And not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, look what it says. No flesh shall be justified. Now we'll get into what justified means in a minute. I just want to say testimonially, I never would have found Jesus if Christianity was simply a set of rules to live by. Years ago, as a non-Christian comedian, the last thing I needed was more rules and regulations. Can you identify? I mean, there was nothing in my heart that thought, I'll check out church because I'm just so excited to have more rules. Man, this is going to be great. And that was my impression until what? Until I came face to face with the gospel, which is what we're looking at today. And so maybe you're there. Maybe, you know, maybe you're here or you're listening or watching on the internet or something. And maybe that was your impression. Well, I would just ask for the grace to put that aside for a second, to open your heart and mind to what really the Bible says is a believer. Now, I remember the only reason I went to church was because there was this Christian girl that invited me. And I remember actually telling her, listen, I'll come as long as you don't force your beliefs on me. Anybody said that to anyone? Say, you don't ram it down my throat, I'll check it out. The moment you do, I'm gone. I said that to her. But then when I saw it, it wasn't about rules, it was about relationship. It wasn't about looking good, it was about getting right. Oh my goodness. And it was just like reversed in my mind, and then it occurred. And I came to see that it occurred to me that the greatest need in my heart was not to sort of hide that sickness or hide that or excuse it or justify it with others and say, well, I'm just like everybody else, so stop judging me. But actually to give it to God and go, here, can you do something with this? Let me suggest that the greatest need anyone has in their life is to be right with God. That's it. The greatest need, if you're a note taker, write that down. But it's not just my greatest need, it's yours too. One of the oldest documents ever written in history, the book of Job. Job says this. He says, how can a man be made right with God? That's the essential question of our existence. And the answer to the question will be the most defining answer, I believe, of your entire life. And Paul brings us the answer right here in Scripture. Now, if you like outlines and things like that or little notes, let me just say this because I want to build how important this passage is. Romans has been called the little New Testament. You know, it's all the foundational truths of our faith wrapped up in one book. But Romans 3, 21 to 26 is called the little Romans. Meaning what? The whole book of Romans is summarized in these five verses. That's why it's so important. We don't just brush over this. And sad to say, a lot of commentators, when you read through here, there's some really huge words in here, and they just kind of brush over them. We're not going to do that. We're going to take our time. Verse 21, look what it says. But now the righteousness of God, apart from the law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Here's the good news that literally screams off the page at us, as you will. And that is that there is a way apart from the law, or apart from sort of that religious concept of doing good and not doing bad. There is a way apart from that which is man's attempt to appease or please God through simply doing works. And Paul says this is witnessed right here. He says, through the law and the prophets. In other words, the law, you know, the first five books of the Old Testament, they call the law. And then you have the prophets after that. His concept here, what Paul is trying to get across is, everybody knows this, everybody's saying this. That's why when Jesus showed up on the scene, he said, it's written of me in the volume of the book. In other words, what? You go through the books of the Old Testament, what do you find? Jesus is all through it. It all points to a coming Messiah. And then we have Jesus show up, and then it all points from the coming Messiah. And so this is great news. He starts by saying this whole concept of do good and don't do bad is not the way. There is a way to be right with God apart from that. That's what he's saying. Now let's have a show of hands. How many of you struggle with road rage? Be honest. I'm going to illustrate. How many of you know that somebody didn't put their hand up and they struggle with road rage? Just point. Is my wife here? See it? Okay. Darn it. Were you pointing at me? Yeah. Thanks. You were? Yeah. Okay. All right. Now, if it's just do better, as religion often has been coined as, you just do better, you just do good, and you don't sin, then all of you that raised your hand are hooped. And I am too, because I struggle in this area of traffic righteousness. I mean, The Bible says that, the flesh lusts after the spirit. What that means is that our flesh goes first and then the spirit follows. Have you found that? I have. You cut me off in traffic. I'm no longer Pastor Joel. I'm wicked. I'm going to get you, Joel. You know what I mean? It is on. I don't really care at that point. And I've said this before, but you know, when it gets really bad and I'm chasing you, then I hear the Holy Spirit through my wife in the passenger seat going, "This is really good, Pastor." Oh, it hurts, right? If faith were based on staying good, I mean, I'm out right there. And it, by the way, are you like this? It's so bad for me that even if I'm driving with someone else, I'll do it for them. You know, that guy cut you off. Get him! Do you do side seat drivers? Any of you? My wife hates it when she's driving and I'm the one in the passenger seat. I'm like, give me that wheel. It is on. And it's not just humans. I do it with animals too. Cats, I'll just steer towards them. Okay, I should let that go. I'm sorry. Cats in my community have like 3 lives each. Anyway, no. But you have to understand this. Usually we're defending the wrong thing. People defend, they're like, "I'm not a bad person." And they love that. They'll go, "I'm not a bad person." Well, what's your definition of bad? Perfect? Yes, you're definitely not perfect. You just admitted that. And if it's not road rage, it's some other rage. But you have to sort of compare and ask on the basis of God's standard or God's definition. The reality is, you and I, we can't go a day, most likely, without sin. Sometimes just an hour without, you say, "Well, I didn't kill anybody." Yeah, but you might have had thoughts that you're like, "That's pretty wicked." And then that seat pocket problem in your heart, you can't just excuse that away by comparing it with somebody else's seat pocket. Your heart's wicked, so's there. Once you start doing this, that's actually religion. Who did Jesus save his harshest words for? Religious people. Most people don't believe that. They think Christianity is religion. But when Jesus shows up on the scene, who's he blasting? The religious people. That's who he goes after. So they're the ones that sort of hit that area and masked and tried to look all good, like they never made mistakes. We call that hypocrisy, and so did Jesus. Now, throughout history, men have asked the same question: how do I be right with God? And as we talked about last week, they search for a way to deal with their guilt. And religion's answer has often been, well, you can't be perfect, but you can be better than the other person. Now, this is sort of part two, if you will. And I think it's neat that if you want, you can go on YouTube right now. Part one's already on there, so you can watch that on your own time. But listen, one author says it this way: man's sense of lostness, loneliness, emptiness, and meaninglessness is reflected in the literature and archaeological remains of every single civilization. So are his fear of death, of existence, if any, beyond the grave, and divine punishment. Nearly every religion is a response to those fears and seeks to offer a way of reaching and satisfying deity. But every religion except Christianity is man-made and work-centered. And for that reason, none of them can succeed in leading a person to be right with God. He goes on to say, the Bible makes it clear there is a way to be right with God, but it's not based on anything man can do themselves or achieve or merit it. Man can be made right with God, not in his own terms or his own power. In that basic regard, don't miss this, Christianity is distinct from every other religion. As far as the way of salvation is concerned, there are therefore only 2 religions the world has ever known or will: the religion of divine accomplishment, which is biblical Christianity, and the religion of human achievement, which includes all other kinds of religion, whatever name they go under. Do you see that? It's what we illustrated last week. Either your definition of religion is we got to do all these things to get up a mountain to reach God, or essentially faith in Jesus is you can't do anything good enough to reach God, so God comes down the mountain and meets you where you're at. Let me give you several reasons why this is so important that we reaffirm and understand this. Perhaps you've been a Christian for a long time, and the truth of this seems somewhat distant or obvious. You're like, yeah, Jesus died, whatever. No. Not whatever. It matters. See, it matters how you function with God just as a believer. It matters how you live, even as a Christian day to day. It matters how you deal with other people, both Christian and non. It changes the way you forgive or don't forgive people, and it also changes the way that you communicate the gospel. In other words, if you want to communicate the gospel correctly, you have to communicate it the way the Bible communicates it. And there's a lot of errors out there today concerning the gospel, and that's what's so amazing. These verses answer them. Now, perhaps you're not in that group. You're just checking out church, Christianity, Jesus, or whatever. And maybe you've had a false impression of what the gospel is. What I want you to know is that if you decide to reject the gospel, that you know exactly what it is you're rejecting. Check out verse 22. Paul goes on. Even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe. For there is no difference. We have to understand that there are misconceptions often about who God is. One, if not the biggest, is the idea that he's an angry father and Jesus is a loving son. This concept, this idea that God the Father is just raging, he's angry and he hates everyone and he's like, oh, I'm going to get him. But the son's like, no, dad, these are great people. And the father's like, well, I ought to. And the son's like, no. You know, and the father's like, okay, son, I guess I'll let you do this. This is so wrong. It does not exist in the Bible anywhere. Reread this verse, I'll point it out. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe, for there is no difference. See, it's more than just a rightness with God. It's a righteousness of God and from God, and I'll show you that in the next verse. And what we're going to point out was the whole idea was God's all along. That God's not this angry guy, and it's like, okay, fine, Jesus, you're the good guy, good cop, bad cop, you know? Fine, we'll do it because you're a good son. That's not the picture. The Bible goes the opposite way. It says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So the concept that he's just mad all the time is not biblical. In fact, it's the opposite. God is the one who so loves you that he has to make a way for you to deal with the, for lack of better words, pukiness in your life. Sin. He doesn't leave you and go, good luck. Try to be better. That's not God. He provides a way, and it's at incredible cost. It's going to be his own son. I would never do that. Do you understand? I might love you. I might like you a lot. But I'm pretty crazy in love with Roman and Cruz, my two boys. And there's just no way I could conceive of going, here, take them in payment for your sins. But God does that. And the second misconception is that Christianity or religion is for good people. Maybe you've had that one, or you've thought that, or you've heard that. Right? Some people go, you know, you guys are... I'm just so bad. Other people will say from the other angle, I'm not good enough to be a Christian. You guys are just so clean. Here he says to all, look at the words, and on all who believe. So with God, it's not predicated by some group and defined by something they do or don't do. Well, if you don't swear, you can be saved. Where's all the non-swearers? Great, come on in. There's nothing like that. God says all, and then he's going to end at the end of this verse, he's going to say there's no difference. So, you have to catch this. Jesus is going to take all your sin and my sin, all our grossness, if you will, on himself. Because God got the idea because of his love for you. And then 2 Corinthians 5:21 says it this way. He said, he made him who knew no sin, that's Jesus, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Now Paul's going to highlight this. Look at verse 23 in Romans 3. He wants us to make sure we're aware of this. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So the first step is you've got to kind of look into the seat pocket and admit that you've sinned. Now, sinned in the Greek, it speaks of, anybody done archery? It's an archery term. It means you've missed the mark once. You've done archery. Maybe you're like me. You've definitely missed the mark once. Right? You don't bullseye it every time. Okay. I've done archery. I remember. And I'm shouting like, get down. Sorry. Right? Injury. Back of some guy's calf. Okay. Don't go archery with me. That's what it is. It doesn't mean that you're sometimes doing good. It means if you miss once, if you miss the mark, problem. Then he uses these words, and fall short of the glory of God. Coming up short, it's sort of linked together with the archery term. I remember in Kelowna years ago, I worked for a TV company and a comedy club, and I thought, oh, I'm going to book the TV company to promote the comedy club. So we did this little thing on the TV show around Kelowna, and we went down to the Okanagan Lake, and we put it on TV, and we said, listen, all of our comedians are going to take our bikes and jump across Lake Okanagan. And it was awesome. The media came out, people came out. It was just a big PR stunt. The idea was we're going to do our best. So these guys got dressed up in crazy things, elephant outfits and all this. And they put this, I said to one of the comedians, build a ramp, nothing major. It's like this, 10-foot ramp. He's like, Joel, this will be awesome. We will get major distance. I drove up onto the ramp, right off, and went straight down like a cartoon character. Golf clap, everybody, right? This comedian did it for himself, and I should have known. He's the only biker in the group. He's like, oh, it'll be amazing. So we end with this guy, and he makes it like 30 feet. It's like incredible. Incredible distance. But you have to understand that this is the idea with righteousness. If you sort of think, well, I can be good enough to get into heaven just because I'm a good person, you have to understand that you so missed the mark. It's the illustration of you doing your best to jump across a 2-mile lake on a bike. That's how short you've fallen. And if you get defensive on that, that's called pride. I did that before I met Jesus. Like, oh, you can't talk about my sin. Who are you, preacher? Come on. And then I would defend, and he'd just sort of take away and go, well, this, yeah, that's sin. Okay, yeah, I've done that. Okay. It's just about being honest about your true condition. And some people might bolster themselves, puff their chest out. Let's say we get Lance Armstrong to do this jump. Ooh, maybe he does 50 feet. It's still not 2 miles. It's still not up to the perfection of a holy, perfect God. Now, instantly, I hear your response. It was mine, too. Well, that's just so unfair, God. He's just so perfect. Come on. But that's the whole point. He doesn't leave you stranded in verse 23. He created verse 24. Let's check it out. Love verse 24. This has got to be favorite verse in the Bible for many of us. The verse that changed my life. Here's what he says. Being justified freely by his grace through redemption that is in Christ Jesus. There it is. Now you say there's a lot of big words in there, and there is. So we're going to walk through them. We don't want to skip over them, but this is amazing. The first thing he says is we're justified freely by his grace. I used this illustration this week with our Connect group, which remains open if you'd like to dive in. Justification, many of you have a word processor, and you can highlight all your words, and then there's this little button in the top section here, and it shows, words straight on either side. And you click on it, and it instantly lines up everything straight. That's what justification means. It means to be made straight before a holy God. You say, well, I thought we can't be made straight. You just said, pukey, problem, fall short. Yes, but hear me out. You're not made straight because of something you did good or didn't do that was bad. Justification, if you take notes, is the act of God whereby he declares the believing sinner righteous in Christ on the basis of another or the finished work of Jesus on the cross. It's an act, not a process. This is not sanctification. Oh, I need to be justified again. No, 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 no. It happens at salvation. It's something God does, not man. And see, no sinner can justify himself before God. He can't be like, well, here's why, and you know, we need to get along. Can't you just overlook this? God is not able to. He's perfect. But he has to provide a way. God is holy. There's no unholiness that can exist in his presence. He can't be like that. He can't deny his character. He can't be ungodlike, if you will. It's not like, well, I can let a little bit of your sin in my presence. We'll just sort of overlook that. So he has a problem, or we have a problem, if you will, that even on our best day, we miss the mark. Even on our best day, we can't jump the distance. So how can we be right with God? We can't. But it starts with God. He wants relationship with us, and the only way he makes it happen is that initiation of providing his son because of his incredible love. And that's why he uses these words. That's why it's through his grace. Look at the words grace here. Grace means undeserved or unmerited favor. The idea is we didn't earn it, we can't buy it, we can only receive it by faith. By believing on what Jesus did on the cross, that it was for us to pay for the pukey seat pocket situation, sin. That's the gospel. And he tells us that we got it through Jesus, through the redemption that is in Jesus. Now, it's interesting, these terms. Justification is sort of the image from the court of law. And it deals with straightness and exact. Redemption, this word here, is an image of the slave market. Justification solves the problem of man's guilt before a righteous judge. Redemption solves the problem of man's slavery to sin, the world, and the devil. If you take notes, redemption, it literally means to let go free for a ransom. And the idea was the recalling of captives. Think slave ship. I always think Charlton Heston. You remember that? Slave ship? Locked? Anybody? Okay, I've just dated myself. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Charlton Heston? Okay. Anyway, slaves in the bottom, tied in, unable to go, on a slave ship. And this is where somebody comes and sets all the slaves free. But redemption doesn't simply work like somebody showing up. And some people think this. They go, oh, that's what salvation is. I just pray a prayer. And listen, you have to understand what you're going for here. The idea is not just somebody sneaks in the night and uncuffs everybody. Let's go. The idea is somebody out in the open comes and buys at a cost every single slave on that ship. Buys them from their slavery. You, me, every single person, and just pays a price. But it goes further than that. See, redemption, the concept here, some have said, and I've said in the past, well, it's like redeeming a coupon, right? Like you go to Safeway and you're like, oh, I have a coupon, and then they give you something back. Great, thanks. And that's really short of the power of this. You're enslaved to your sin. You're tied up to it. There's no way of getting off the ship. Someone comes boldly and buys you back. But then it goes one extra level because it's like ransom. How do they buy you back? With their own life. That's redemption. That's what Jesus did. He didn't go, how much for Johnny? $3,000. Oh, that's a tight one, but okay. Well, you take two. It's not like that. He's going to buy you back, whoever you are. And this set me free as a non-Christian years ago. That he would buy me back, even though I deserve it. The Bible says the cost of that grossness, that wickedness, that sin is death. The wages of sin is death. And a perfect God cannot look on it, but there must be a payment. And Jesus comes along and says, I'm going to pay for all of them. Okay, is it money? No, no, no. It's my own life, my own blood. Can you imagine if somebody set you free from slavery? We can't because we're not in that culture. But if we're in slavery culture, the greatest thing is freedom. But when you know the guy, you paid for me? Thanks. And I had no way of getting out. But the gospel message goes beyond thanks. You got me out. And it goes right into what? paid for me with your own perfect life? Your death on a cross? You gave your life to free me? The life of the owner. Jesus says it this way in John 8:34. I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. But then he says, however, if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I am so sorry if you're in this place and you've been sold on something that is not the message of the Christian faith. You've been sold on try harder, or just, you know, that, you know what that does? It makes you repel places like this. You're like, okay, well, I'll sit through it for you, buddy. Right? That's what it did to me. But when you see that all that stuff that you excuse, or you find ways to deal with it in your own, you either drink it away or you buy it away. You go, you appease your flesh by buying things. Or drugs, you just like escape from it for a moment. For some of you, it's sexual impurity. You're like, I just need to find love. And so that's what you do. You have to understand, God is so in love with the idea of buying you back from that, that he sent his son Jesus. God so wants you to see that his concept of redemption is that he will pay it in full once on the cross. That you don't have to pay through all the things that you do to escape or whatever. Then he uses, and again, this word grace, just one more thing before we do the next verse. In the original definition, the word grace means a giving that is motivated purely by the giver and by nothing in the one who receives. Isn't that awesome? So you have no way of making it across the lake of righteousness, but Jesus, because of God's love for you, God sends his son to make this bridge through his own righteousness to redeem you, simply because of God's grace and his love. Verse 25. Then he says this. Oh, I love this verse. Whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God passed over the sins that were previously committed. Propitiation, what does that mean, Joel? The word in its form here is used, you know, in the classical form, it was like this idea of appeasing the Greek gods by using sacrifice. In other words, in the Greek concept, in their minds, the idea was that you sort of offered to buy off the anger of the gods. But as we've already said, that's not the true definition. And this word, helasteron, is used in the Septuagint for, it more speaks of the words mercy seat. You know what that was? It was the lid that covered in the temple. You go into the Holy of Holies and you had the Ark of the Covenant, this amazing thing. I'd love to take time to show you it. And there was this seat that basically was called the mercy seat, and upon which the sacrificial blood was sprinkled as a temporary atonement, if you will, for sin. And what he's essentially saying here is that Jesus is our mercy seat. If you will, grace is mercy is not getting what we do deserve. Grace is getting what we don't deserve. And so the idea here that we don't get what we deserve because Jesus went and took the punishment upon himself. That's propitiation. And this concept that it was paid for by him shows that somehow Jesus didn't appease, it was paid for by God, sorry. It shows that somehow Jesus didn't appease the anger or the reluctancy of an unwilling father to hold back his wrath. Rather, instead, it was God the Father. Look what it says, who initiated. The Bible says here, whom God set forth. Does that change your concept of angry God? This was God's idea. So you kind of go back and you go, the Bible says this was a plan from the foundation of the earth, meaning God knew. He went, oh, you know, they're going to mess up, but one day I'm going to send Jesus because I love them. And it's not like the opposite way either. You know, no, God's loving and Jesus is ticked that he got chosen. It's not that, as some think. Oh, Jesus, like, really? Couldn't you send a commander? That's not it. Because the Bible tells us elsewhere in the New Testament, Jesus, whom for the joy set before him, suffered the cross. What's the joy? It's two things. His obedience and alignment with his Father's will. And don't miss this. You know what else it is? The joy for Jesus before he went to the cross? It's you. It's you. What do you mean? Well, the joy set before him was, I'm going to go to the cross in obedience to my Father. And I'm going to allow the mercy of God to come into people's lives that they don't get what they deserve, propitiation. And in doing so, I'm going to make a way to the Father through faith in me and what I've done. And that was the joy, so that one day you and me could simply come by faith. That is being persuaded in the original language. Being persuaded both in heart and mind and say, yes, I receive that. I receive that what you did on the cross, Jesus, was for me. I might have fought it my whole life. I might have fought it right up to the point of listening now. But now I receive it. Now I get it. Verse 26, he closes out. He says, to demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Church, listen, at the cross, God demonstrated his righteousness by offering man justification, a legal verdict, if you will, of not guilty, while remaining completely just. Because the righteous penalty of our sin was paid for at the cross. It's amazing. One commentator writes, it's easy to see how God could be only just, simply send every guilty sinner to hell as a just judge. It's also easy to see how God could be the justifier, simply tell every guilty sinner, I declare a pardon. You are all declared not guilty. But only God could find a way to be both just and the justifier of the one who has simple faith in Jesus. You say, well, okay, what do I have to do to be made right with God? You know what? It's really simple. It'll astound you. It astounded me at first. I thought there's got to be a catch. No catch. First thing is, be honest. Be honest. The Bible says God opposes the proud. Right? He just comes against us when we will push away from him and go, no, I don't have anything in my seat pocket. But he gives grace to the humble. How do we receive the grace of God? By being honest. And some of you, you'll go your whole life and you'll say, oh, I'm not going to help those grumpy Christians. It's not about the people on the right or the left of you or your family or that crazy Christian you know. It's not even about the bad example. That's the one I used to use, you know. I was on a plane doing comedy, flying across Canada, and like I always sit next to like the guy that was like preacher guy, you know. Oh, I can't stand this guy. And then when I got saved, I was on a plane, and I would be that guy. And I would sit next to people, and I remember one guy, and he's like, oh, you know what, I'd be interested in God if it weren't for all the Christians. And I would look at him and say, you know what, dude, get over it. If you're going to make your faith, like your salvation based on some bad example, forget the one bad example, the guy who burnt you. I can give you 20 or 30. It's not about people. It's about Jesus. It's not about some person that let you down who was a Christian. Move on. Deal with God alone and what he says, because I promise you, this is true, this is real, and you will give an account. You go, oh, there's the heavy. No, it's the heavy plea for you to run to the cross, as the Bible says, and receive freely the grace of God. You got to be honest. You got to be honest with God. And in return, you receive what? Free grace. Your sins are paid in full through the blood of Jesus. And I'm going to end with one thing here. Turn to Acts, if you will, please. 16, verse 31. Acts 16, 31. I just love the simple definition here. Paul and Silas in jail, they meet this jailer, and they have this awesome moment where God shakes the foundations of the jail, and this miracle happens, and then it's them and the jailer. And this guy sort of calls out in verse 30. He says, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" He sees the power of God at work, and he wants to know, whoa, God is real. How do I get right? Look at the response. "So they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." Awesome. In Romans, he says, believe in Jesus. Here he adds emphasis. That little preposition, he says, believe on Jesus. I've sort of described it like this. Where's a chair when you need one? Never mind. Imagine a chair here. It is one thing for me to look at that chair and go, great, it's a chair. Yeah, I can believe in that. Sure, it's a chair. It's a whole nother thing for me to believe that that chair will support my weight. But it goes beyond that the moment that I put myself in that chair. I'm believing on the chair that it will hold my weight. Very different. Why do you say that? So I think for years, I kind of thought, I'm a Christian. Why? Well, you know, I believe that there is a God. I kind of believed in, but I didn't put my faith on Jesus. I didn't sort of go, okay, my whole life's going to be supported by you, Jesus. I'm going all in. I just from a distance went, okay, fine, preacher guy, here, I'll believe in the facts. Well, the Bible, Jesus said, hey, even the demons believe. That's not a good correlation, right? It's like, you and demons, not good. There's a difference between believing in and believing on. That's where I take the seat pocket of my life and I give it to him. And in exchange, he gives me his righteousness. And he pours out his undeserved favor, his grace on my life. And there's forgiveness. But more than just forgiveness, there's redemption. I'm made right once and for all. I'm going to call the worship team up. We're going to worship right now. And as we're worshiping, I just want to invite you first just to ponder these things and to ask that question, am I right with God according to what I just heard? Has the gospel set me free from my sin? Or is it something I'm defending? Is it something I'm excusing? Do I know God through his Son, Jesus Christ?